Last week, which book were we dealing with? Ephesians chapter 3. I mean chapter 1 and 2. And so we were dealing with, in Ephesians chapter 1 and 2, essence of it is that you're dealing with a church that has Gentiles in it and as well as Jews in it under the same umbrella of walking in Christ. What he's underscoring in chapter 1 and 2 from last week, the apostle is emphasizing the fact that both sides had to leave something to have Christ. For the Jews, they were going to leave Judaism to come to faith in Christ. And for the Gentiles, they would leave paganism to come in faith with Christ. So both parties would have to leave something in order, let me use the term, that we might win Christ. And you're going to hear that tonight. It's things that we have to leave from in order that we might win Christ. And in our, how that relates in our own lives concerning things that we would have to leave from, ties or traditions that we may have had, that we have to leave those things that we might obtain Christ. That makes a lot of sense, right? And so he lays that out in chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Ephesians and puts great emphasis on it because it is so important, because we know that Judaism and belief in Christ was not going to work hand in hand. Neither worshiping idols and walking with Christ was not going to work. They don't go hand in hand. So therefore, they departed from their old man and they entered into a new life. Any questions so far on that? Okay, we can just wrap up. You got it? Can you teach that just like that? You said yes. Did you say that? Yes? Okay. Yes, sir. Question. Paganism, the worship of idols, or just knowing nothing, don't know anything about God, wondering about God. So what they would do is that in the human fallen nature, they're going to create something that is God, because it's in the nature of everybody to, whether they confess it or not, to look to a higher order. So we've seen historical record where people worship something, you know, whether it was multiple God worships, they just made up their gods. Whether they make up a god called Dagon, it's in the human nature to know that there's a supreme being above them, even though they were worshiping idols. But just the need to know that there is a God, whether it's the weather god, the water god, the frog god in Egypt, the 10 gods of Egypt, and all those things who God overthrew, and the Nile God and the God of fertility. But to come to Christ, they would have to leave all that, leaving those things behind. And so it was just as much challenge for them to depart from pagan worship, and the Jews to depart from the deep traditions of the law of Moses. That being a Jew with all its history, they would have to, you know, put that aside to have Christ. And so they were persecuted for that and disliked for that. Pharisees were trying to hold on to the traditions. Abraham is our father. And therefore, in doing so, they were putting up a cause for rejecting Christ. So the faith that we're called into, we always leave something. Israel was in bondage, but before they got to the promised land, they had to leave Egypt. They had to leave Egypt. And all the things and the bondages, and God made a way for them to depart from the way of the world. Egypt was the type of the world. Pharaoh was a type of the devil. And they forsook Egypt to pursue that which was rich and that which was real, which was the living God. And then when the gospel began to be preached, Gentiles believed. And as they began to believe, there was somewhat of a transition period to see whether the two could mesh together. And so it was the ministry of the apostle who was saying from the very beginning, the mystery that was not revealed yet from the very beginning is that the Gentiles were going to be partakers of the same promise and be the seed of Abraham too. But they would be the seed of Abraham by faith, and or rather through faith, that through faith they would be the seed of Abraham, therefore equally partakers of the promise. And some people had a hard time with that. And so you find in Galatia and different other scriptures where Judaizers would come in and say, hey, you must be circumcised in order to be saved, because their tradition had such a lock on them that while they were free, they felt like, you know, there are those who said, but you got to do this. You got to do this to be saved. And whereas they were not the things that would bring salvation. Salvation would come through faith as a response to the gift of God called grace. So that answer your question, what they walked away from? And when it comes to our lives, we also walked away from something. No one came to Jesus and remained the same. There are things that we walked away from, belief systems that we walked away from. Am I right? And belief system that was just kind of made up as we went, but they were belief systems. So that's why you see the apostle giving, let him that steals steal no more, because somewhere there's a belief system that was right to steal. And so I was having a conversation with a dear brother who deals with security, and he was just saying that, you know, people just try to steal all the time. Can you imagine that people try to steal all the time? And I began to reflect back in the days when I used to work for a department store, how some of the people that were unloading the trucks back then saw some boxes that they thought should be theirs without having to pay for it. And you know what that's called? That's what that's called. That's called stealing. And so I was just reflecting back on some of the things that people did back in those times. But when you're locked into a belief system that kind of concludes that, yeah, it's right to steal. Everybody got to look out for themselves. But you can't look out for yourself by taking what belongs to somebody else. So he said, now that you're in Christ, him that steals, steal no more. And believe it or not, that was a change. What's norm for you was a change for them. That's major. And, you know, our growth in God, it's not determined alone by what you don't do anymore. We celebrate what we don't do anymore because light has come and we become aware, and so we don't do that anymore. But that's not the real foundation of our faith. Our faith is revealed based on what we do. You know the scripture, whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. And then the scripture will go on to say, we will know who the people that are in Christ based on their fruit, because fruit is a product of something on the inside. The workings of the inside of the tree or the plant producing fruit is a principle, and principles don't change. So Jesus used the terminology, you shall know them by their fruit, speaking about us, not just by our words, but really by our fruit. Simply saying, if you see apples on a tree, what type of tree is it? Okay, if you see adultery on a tree, that's past. I think you get my point, right? So now we're going to move in, but we're going to jump to another passage of scripture in Philippians just to kind of solidify the teachings of the first two chapters of Ephesians. Then we're going to loop back around at another time for Ephesians. But this is so important that we understand the simplicity of the gospel is a departing from Egypt. And Egypt is a type of what? The world. That's right. And so God made a way by putting what on the doorposts? He put blood on the doorposts, and he said, when I see what? When I see the blood, I'm going to pass over you. And so it is now with Christ. It's the blood of Jesus that causes the wrath of God to be applied to him and not to us. that he suffered and died for us so that we wouldn't have to suffer and pay a price that we could not pay. And so we take serious and highly exalt the blood of Jesus. The Bible says through life, the believers overcame by the blood of the Lamb. And what else? And by the word of their testimony. Boldly, the word of their testimony. And everyone who has gone through the transition from old life to new life, dead in sin and born again, has a testimony. It doesn't mean you're going to have to make it publicly, in front of a crowd, but just when the opportunity arises, everyone in Christ has some testimony about what Christ has done for you. Now, so let's, with that in mind, let's visit this passage of Scripture in Philippians chapter 3. And it says, "For we are the circumcision who worship God in the Spirit, rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh." How much confidence in the flesh? None. No confidence in the flesh. Because your flesh will betray you. It always will. It always has. It will betray you. So therefore, you give no place for the flesh to be activated, but rather you keep the flesh buried. And if you don't like the burial concept, well, how about crucifying it? That way we can have a living sacrifice and you can feel the effects of it. "Though I also might have confidence in the flesh." Well, why would you have confidence in the flesh, Paul? "If anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more. So, circumcised the eighth day," you say, wow. That's a big deal, circumcised the eighth day. Wow. That means you're part of the covenant. And of the stock of Israel, you say, wow. Of the tribe of Benjamin, whoa. Okay, come on, get excited about this. This is quite a resume. "A Hebrew of Hebrews." Ooh, we're getting deep now. Just Hebrews of Hebrews. In other words, I was an excellent Hebrew. Okay. "Concerning the law," talking about the law of Moses, I was a Pharisee. "Concerning zeal," I persecuted the church, Jack. "Concerning righteousness, which is in the law," blameless. Isn't that something? He got it going on. "However, but what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ." See, I had to leave something. I had to leave my resume of what I accomplished and the stock I'm coming from and the tribe I'm from and my religious order that I came from. And as far as touching the law, blameless, because there was no one around probably to blame you for anything. But if they would look hard enough, they would have found you. "But the things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed, I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord." For the excellence of the knowledge, just to know him. Let's go a little further. "And be found in him, not having my own righteousness," Hebrew of Hebrews, a Pharisee of the tribe of Benjamin, "not having my own righteousness." Very important. "But that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith." 10th verse, "that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead." Powerful words. But it emphasized the departing from one thing and the entering into a new faith. Faith was new. The continuance of faith was enlightening for the Jew and brand new for the Gentile. Now, let's look at that for a moment Just pause for a little bit, and let's go over to Romans chapter 3, and I'm going to start at the 29th verse, Romans 3 and 29. And it just simply says, "Or is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also the God of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. Since there is one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith." What do you think that means? That for the Jews, they would be justified by faith, and for the Gentiles, through faith. It almost seems like it's the same thing, but it's not. They use the two terminologies to differentiate something, to make us aware of something, to pause that the Jews were justified by faith and the Gentiles through faith. We got a by and a through. Okay? By faith is the same faith that was established with Abraham. The faith of Abraham. And so that was a continuation. To respond by faith would be a norm. Now, we know we got into the law in order to make them guilty through the law of Moses so they wouldn't be high-minded, so they would know that salvation is a gift from God and that it's not of works. And so now when he says through faith, it's through the newfound faith that they were coming into. It was brought up in the early Bible study that the question was, they were at the Jerusalem Council because we want to know what we're going to do with these Gentiles who have been baptized in the Holy Spirit. These Gentiles who received the same Holy Spirit, same experience, spoke in other tongues just like we had. And then some people were saying, believing Pharisees, but they got to be circumcised. They got to keep the law of Moses, but they were believing Pharisees. It actually says that. So now, this is a transition. This is not going to be the norm. You probably believe some things that went right at some time in your new faith. I make mention of the fact that two brothers down home, when they got saved, they thought they were the two witnesses. So they were walking around Franklin thinking that they were the two witnesses. And God just let them have that in their innocence. But they found out they're not. They weren't. They were not. And some things you just got to let go and let God work it out, you know. And I think they may have put on kind of some garments, like, you know, they were walking around waiting for the opportunity to, you know, bring down fire. So, but they, in their zeal, God was merciful, okay? Because if Paul is touching zeal, he persecuted the church. So, and was he right to do that? Absolutely not. So we go a little, looking at this. I want to read that same scripture in Amplified. Or is God the God of the Jews only? Is he not also the God of the Gentiles who were not given the law? That's good. Yes, of Gentiles also, since indeed it is one and the same God who will justify the circumcised by faith, which began with Abraham, and the uncircumcised through faith, their newly acquired faith. So that God will make all things one, which was his original intent. So you can imagine people that was on opposing viewpoints are now coming together in a new place, not bringing with them any of the old with them. Did you catch that? They couldn't bring any old paganism with them, and they couldn't bring any old Judaism with them. Now, at the Jerusalem Council, they were wondering what we're going to do with these Gentiles. And he said, well, just have them to, James made the judgment call. The rest of the apostles and disciples were in agreement, ultimately. But they were disputing. There was dissension about, you know, the law of Moses and they having to keep the law. And he said, this is my decision. First of all, how is it that you're trying to lay on them burdens that you couldn't keep yourself as Jews? So let's just keep it real. We couldn't keep the law. Now, why are you trying to bind them with it? So then, secondly, he goes on to say that this is my judgment. James is saying this. This is the brother of Jesus. He said, this is my judgment. This is my decree. This is my decision that they stay away from immorality, that they stay away from fornication and sexual immorality, that they stay away from things offered to idols, idolatry, paganism, things strangled in the eating of blood. And if they do that, that's a good beginning. They're going to do well if they just start there, because if anyone checks their morality and then checks their belief system, as far as their pagan belief system, they're going to do real good. And then God is going to continue showing them the light as they walk in the light. So I want you to see that this just wasn't just a easy transition per se, easy from the standpoint that there's an obstacle, is something that Satan could use, and that created conflicts, and that created challenges. But yet, faith prevailed. And it took Paul all his life to preach this message of faith. So it was believed by some, but for the whole church to gravitate to the depth of this truth and the simplicity of it, it pretty much took him his life to do that. And guess what? It'll take us our life too to fulfill the course that God has given us. No matter what it is, how he's ordained and called you to serve him, we will be doing that. It will take our life to do this. So at least I'm telling you ahead of time that this is going to cost us our life, that we might gain, Christ. So the preaching of an easy message that, without saying it, allows people to stay stuck in what God would want them to leave is inappropriate, because this gospel message is about change. Everything changes in Christ. So do you understand this? That this is costing something for a greater gain. Yes.
So when Paul says to gain Christ, what exactly does that mean?
To gain and to grow in the awareness and to be partakers of the communion of the Holy Spirit with the sovereignty of God. That when he said, Lord, make them one, then that was a decree. That was a request that he asked his Father, not just so that, you know, we could just go to church together and high five, making one in the knowledge of Christ, that I might know him. Not that I know him in all aspects, but my life is a growing life. And in my growth, I'm going to change into the glorious image of the dear Son that gave his life for me, that his children should look back like the one from whom they were born. In the natural, the baby has, I see the little baby back there in the back, right there. I guarantee you that baby, just hold the baby up right there, the testimony of the Lord right there. And that baby has got his daddy's DNA and his mama's DNA. It's a rule. It is a rule. And so is the rule also that those who are in Christ would be like him. Didn't the scripture say that when he shall appear, we don't know what we shall be, but when he appears, we know this, we're going to be like him. Listen to that constitution. We're going to be like him. We're not going to be playing with the Taliban then jumping back over with Jesus. No, we're going to be like him. Amen. Somebody ought to preach that. I think he just did. So now, therefore, the scripture, the next scripture I'm going to review with you is in Titus. This was spoken Sunday But there's something very profound, and the Lord wants me to give it to you. He wants you to have it, okay? The 11th verse of Titus 2, if you would, Titus 2 and 11. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. The grace of God, the influence of God has appeared to all men. Think about that just for a moment. Teaching us this grace, because we love to say we've been saved by grace. Well, grace teaches. Right? Say amen to that. Yeah, we've been saved by grace, but grace teaches. Not just saved by grace so that you can stay stuck, but saved by grace that you might be taught. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. And I'm glad that grace teaches. I'm glad that the influence of God teaches us, or we will be stuck in something that we need to depart from. So not out of rebuke, but out of teaching, the grace of God that has appeared to all men, teaching us. What are you going to teach us, Dr. Grace? Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, not drunk, righteously and godly in this present age. Okay. Looking, desiring, having a passion for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Okay? With me so far? So, I'm going to pause just for a moment because we talked a little bit about this Sunday, but the passion in our hearts should be for the appearance of Jesus Christ. It is the next great thing on God's agenda. Well, you say, wait a minute. God, he just wants souls upon souls upon souls upon souls. And he would that no man perish. But listen, there is a divine clock that God will implement things in the seasons that is due, and which would include coming for his people, because he promised to do it. And so the body of Christ got in such a pickle that they fought over when, time slots, and argued and divided over it and overlooked the fact that he said he's coming. He's coming. And I will add this, guess what? He's going to come when he wants to come. He that shall come will come. It's an act of will, God's will. He that shall come will come and will not tarry. So he won't be slowly on his way, that he's coming like, you know, he's mid-trip. Nope. Suddenly he shall appear. Then we understand from Sunday's teaching, when he comes, he encouraged us, said, no man knows the hour. No one knows the day when I'm coming. Don't be getting it together, be together. Don't be getting ready, be ready. Have your lamps full of oil and take you some extra oil for the journey. Because you don't know that as the bridegroom delays and you fall asleep because you were tired, that when the announcer says, behold, come you out to meet him, that you are ready to trim your wick, light your lamp, and perform the duty of that wedding processional. So now with that in mind, let's look at a little further in the scripture, and I want you to think about this now, that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So if they were looking for his appearance, then guess what? Okay. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous of good works. What does that mean? Now, look. Let me do a little backstory. So when God wanted to proliferate mankind, he created Adam. He made him from the dust of the ground, at least his body was, and he gave him Eve, and they are to be fruitful and do what? Multiply. But he only chose two people, right? And so then as we go on, and then you've got Noah, because the world got evil, and he chose how many people? Eight people were found righteous. Eight people. Now the world's going to perish, and eight people are going to make it. All right. And so there came a time with Sodom and Gomorrah. Who came out? Lot. His wife didn't make it too far. She didn't make it too far, though. She came out. But she had something that she didn't want to leave. You should hear the preacher preach here. There was something behind her that she still wanted. And the Lord said, don't look back. There's nothing back there good for you. That's why the Bible says, come out from among them and be ye separate. And I will receive you, says the Lord. So there's some things behind us that are no good for us. And you say amen. And so, but let those things be behind us and let us press forward for what's in front of us. The windshield is bigger than the rearview mirror for a reason. Because there's more in front of us that's good for us than even the good that's behind us. Can I tell you, the best days for everybody in here are yet in front of us. It's in front of us, the best day. So no need to be sad because, you know, you're a card-carrying member like me. And, you know, I've heard people say, well, you know, I'm getting old now. I'm getting old. But morning by morning, new mercies I see. There's yet aspects of God to know. You don't get so too old that you can't know him, because you cannot rise to the pinnacle of your calling. And at 89, you might know him. And so we're going to discount the fact that I'm old, but my spirit is not old. Because if you're having new mercies day by day, that means that, you know, though this outward man perish, I know you wanted Bible for it, didn't you? You were sitting there saying, I wish he would give me Bible for it. You were feeling that way, weren't you, Anthony? Yeah, why don't he give me Bible for it? I don't blame you. I would ask for it too. Though this outward man perish, the inward man is renewed. How often? Day by day, made new day by day. So my spirit is not aging, just like the Ancient of Days is not aging either. He's always the same. And born again is always the same. Praise the Lord Jesus. And so therefore, even as this body, this outward man is growing old and declining, the inner man is being renewed. How am I being renewed? Because of I eat vegetables that may help the body, but my inner man is being renewed because I'm feasting on Christ and I'm 90 years old and still chewing good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is, he's good, y'all. And so we might as well set expectations right so you don't take a dip because of temporal time or aging and changing of the body. because what's in front of us is greater than that which is behind us. And the Apostle Paul making these statements is not saying it as an old young man. He's saying it as a man that is maturing, and he's saying that I might know him. That all of my pedigree and all of my accomplishments, I count it as a Pharisee, I count it as dung, that I might win Christ, that I may have communion with him, that I may obtain a better resurrection. So how else is a man going to say to live as Christ and to die as gain? It would be great for you that I stay with you, but it's better for me that I depart and be with the Lord. Didn't he say it? So he didn't have no problem about departure, and where this doctrine came in of departure being horrible is off pace with the scripture. Come on and praise him right there. Just think about a race. It's off pace with the scripture. It doesn't line up with the scripture. It's not the rules of the race. Because he that has promised us everything has a security for us in every stage of life. And listen to the cry of the apostle, that I may be found in him. That I'm pressing away from all the noise of the world. That I may keep my mind focused and stayed on him. Because perfect peace comes that way. For everybody who's fastened to, whose thoughts and mind and expression and attitude and dispositions are stayed on Christ. And so now, this is, you ready for the ringer? Okay. I want to say, if the apostles were looking for his appearance, you should be looking for his appearance too. All right, so I'm going to have to repeat this on Sunday so you act real like, oh, that's right. Woo! Come on now, if y'all sit there and do this, you've been done me wrong. So I'm giving you a leak ahead of time, so at least when you hear it again, just go, amen, and I will be looking at you. And so anyway, looking for the blessed key word, hope. Remember Sunday when I said everyone who had this hope within him purifies himself even as he is pure. So how is it that the coming of the Lord is activated in us so strong and so passionately with high expectation is because of the activity of hope making his appearance real to us. Follow me now. Making his appearance real on the inside before you see it with your eyes. Jesus was slain before the foundation of the world, right? Now, so it was uttered and decreed and settled. And that was a reality when it come to God. Even though it would take thousands of years for its fruition to be manifested at Calvary. It was a done deal when it was declared. So likewise, the energy that comes from hope causes a spiritual activity in our soul that lifts us up above the things of this world. That we may be partakers of Christ seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That we have this hope because we live by faith, not by sight. So the appearance of the Lord, of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ down in our soul activates a longing for him that lifts you. So that you won't be entangled with the wiles of the enemy and the pressures of the world, but lifted so that, here comes the ringer now. Look at your name and say, here he comes. All right, I told you, Two people with Adam and Eve, eight people with Noah. How many people with Sodom and Gomorrah? We got three girls because the wife didn't make it. She had high blood pressure, too much salt. We told you about that salt, you just can't do that. That was corny, wasn't it? But we enjoyed it, didn't we? Didn't we? So anyway, remember Lot's wife. Don't look back. Press forward to the high calling that's in Christ Jesus. There's a forward for all of us. There's a moving forward for us all. So that's why you don't latch on and stay latched to that which is old. That which God is drawing you from, that your flesh thinks it needs to have. But guess what? Your flesh is lying to you. That's just, all right, it's the truth, though. It is the truth. So anyway, now let's look at the scripture together. We see that Christ comes to the scene and he chooses how many people? 12 people. All right? When before then, Israel rebelled. He chose a nation and Israel rebelled. Who was he going to use to make a new nation? Moses. Moses was in a scene. He said, no, I'll start a new nation with you. I'll do what I want to do with you. And so he interceded for the nation, and God relented. And then the people got on his nerves. So where am I going with this? Looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify, sanctify, separate for himself his own special people. Now, I'm not big-headed and I'm not arrogant, but his own special people are special people. They are people that have made themselves ready for their Lord. They are special. They don't hang out with the Taliban and then come and join the American troops later. They're special people. And they're called holy nation, royal priesthood. They've been called sanctified, set apart for God, and set apart from the world. You see, when we think about the move of God, we think about masses of people. But the true thing that we should first look like is the purpose of God. And that while there will be a lot of people in heaven, but in comparison to the number of people who are not in heaven, it would seem to be a less number. It is a less number because wide and spacious is the road that leads to destruction, and many shall find it. And straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leads to life, and few in comparison, because God is more concerned about a people prepared for him that is his own people, sanctified and not deluded. And so the season and the time that we have, that we are admonished, encouraged, strengthened, forgiven to mature us to be his holy, special people, so that when you whisper, Lord, he'll say, here I am. Come on now. Your baby can't even say, mommy, in from the other room. A mother knows what mommy sounds like. Is it a cry of distress? Is the baby afraid? And so the mom, dad too, I'm not taking dad out of this, will make the move to attend to that child, to that baby. Now we have the baby who's the example, raise the baby up again. It's God's anointing the baby right now for the master's use. Come on now, for the master's use. That's right, with no shoes on, because the baby knows he's on holy ground. So now, if that baby whimpers a certain way or have a scream-like cry, I don't know which one of you two would beat the race getting to the baby. What did you say? Oh, it's even mom. And dad said, the baby calling you. But you see my point. What I'm going to amplify in you is this communion with Jesus, this coming together. Yes, we are not made of what we don't do alone, but what we do, our expectation, our hope, our communion with him, our time with him, our thoughts, the things we won't tolerate in our mind. If I won't tolerate an ungodly, worldly song that's back from the day, and I'm going to wrestle with that thing for 2 days and say, no, this is going to stop. This is going to stop. I'm not waking up to that beat. So what you do is not what I stopped doing, it's what I added to my faith. So I put my earphones on and I got my playlist and it started downloading refreshing light. It started downloading words and music and notes and everything that would glorify God. And it washed out everything, that even just every little nugget. And so everyone at any time may need a good flushing, but it will be based on what you do, right? It's based on what you do. Other than that, we'll find ourselves battling and wrestling with the flesh. We shouldn't wrestle with the flesh. We are wrestling with angels and fallen angels and principalities and demons and putting them in check as regard to our person, but with the flesh. You don't wrestle with the flesh. You kill that. You crucify the flesh. Reckon yourself to be dead, that Christ will live in you. So that scripture tells us, with regard of comparison to the what God is important to him, is it the masses of numbers that are going to make him feel better, or is it faith in a few versus unbelief in a mass? Which one you think he wants? Yeah. What is better? Faith in few. Because the numbers don't excite God. It's faith that excites God. And if that be in great numbers, praise God. But when you're thinking about the plan of God, it is to bring about faith to influence you. The grace of God has appeared to all men that you may deny ungodly. Isn't it amazing? Right on the top that you are just deny ungodly lust. Why would he tell you to do that? For checking the box? No, because there's so many consequences mentally because of it. And no war like the war in your head. And you can't open the gate to let the enemy into your mind. And this is just sound teaching for the believer, that you keep yourself in the love of God and see that no man takes your crown. That you want to fight to maintain your status, fighting the good fight. Not legalism, but a good fight of faith. My response to the grace of God that's appeared to all men. So that by faith now, not in my own righteousness, but the righteousness that comes by faith, the energy that comes by faith, the exertion of God's power that comes through faith, that enables us to rise above the human factor that we may be partakers of his divine nature, according to the scripture. So this is our pursuit now. It's not that I've counted myself perfect, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things that be behind me. I'm cutting that loose. I'm not going to be shackled with that anymore. I'm going to press forward to the high calling and the mark of the high calling that's in Christ Jesus. Amen. So therefore now, I just want to, that God is securing, and the reason this is so important, you ever heard this statement? That's what's wrong with the church today. Raise your hand if you've heard people say that before. I want to jump up and just squeeze them by the neck, but I can't do that because I'm your pastor and I don't need you to defend while I'm choking people out. Listen, this is very critical. You ready? There's nothing wrong with the church. Do you know who the head of the church is? Jesus. What's wrong with him? That I might be like him. That I might know him. That I be found in him. Do you see all the benefits that is spoken concerning the church? That we are seated with him in heavenly places, far above principalities and powers, that the angels are now designed to look in the manifold wisdom of God by looking at the church. And I'm going to tell you something, there's nothing wrong with the Lord's separated, secured people who have faith in him. I didn't say the people were perfect, they just have faith in him. That in any flaws, it's reconciled by faith, and we put those things behind us. Amen? And so when the Bible says, he said that when I return, will I find what on the earth? Didn't say people. He didn't say crowds of people. He said, will I find faith on the earth? There should be no passion, none, in the human experience that is co-equal, co-regent with our passion for Christ. If any man comes after me and not prefer me above father, mother, brother, sister, wife, and yea, your own life, he cannot be my disciple. Wow. I know that's highlighted in your Bible. But what does it get down to? Put that scripture back up for me, if you would, brother. That he's redeemed us, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own. So somebody say, do you know Pastor Ricks? You say, yeah, he's special. I don't mind. Say, you know, he's special. Yeah, he's a special need. I do. I need him, let's see, every hour? No, that's too long. Every minute? Oh, that'd be too long. Every second? Yeah. But the joy of being called special. Go ahead and say it. I know you want to say, Pastor special. But did you know that? But I've been knowing that you're special for a long time. Yeah. But I'm okay with it. I'm welcoming it. Because look what he did to isolate his own special people. You say, well, are you talking being exclusive? Absolutely. Yes, I am. Of course I am. because of the price that was paid to purchase that which is special. Think about it. Redeem means to buy back, to purchase back. I'll take it. Not because they were worthy, but because he's worthy. That he may purify for himself, clean you up, fix you up, forgive you, cleanse you, stand you up, spank your little hips. Yeah, that's in there too. My mama wouldn't say that. She said, I'm going to wear your hips out. Wow, that means I would have none left. Call children's services. Purify for himself his own, isn't that rich? His own special people in Montana, in Kentucky, in Ohio, in Rome, in Australia, Ethiopia, South Africa. His own special people out of every nation and every language and every tribal group, out of not every tribe, not every people in every nation, no, out of every nation. You see the pattern? Wow. And it's not that God's not able, it's that he is just, the grace of God has appeared to teaching us, teaching us. And so when we hear truth, we adhere to truth. And we, by faith, not by fear, by faith, because having fear of hell will never sustain you. And trying won't sustain you. Trusting is the only thing that makes a way for us. You ever notice that he never said, try in the Lord? He said, trust in the Lord. Am I talking about legalistic perfection? I am not. I'm talking the opposite. I'm talking about the freedom of faith and the energy and power that comes from it when it's exercised through us based on the power of his grace given to us, that he enables us to glorify his wonderful name. I want to wrap up tonight by saying that he has secured for himself his own special people. In one place he said that you, talking to Israel, he said that you would be a peculiar treasure unto me. And then he came in the new covenant and said that we are not only a chosen generation, a peculiar people. That doesn't mean strange. That means purchased. We are purchased people. Because, and I want to put a cap on this, why is he making a special people for himself in this dispensation? Why do you think he's doing it? He's got agendas, he's got objectives, and he's got plans. And in this plan, remember I told you, his plan that he's going to include humans in his plan. In his eternal plan, he's got people, humans, because there's a millennial time period that's coming. And there's a new heaven and a new earth time period that's coming. And he's prepared a people now for then, because God's got his stuff together. Amen? And what's our takeaway tonight? What's our takeaway? You can stand while you give me a takeaway. That gives you a sign that we're going to wrap up. Say it again. Leaving behind things that need to be left behind. Don't worry about it no more. Forgetting those things that be behind. That's right. All right? Anybody else? Takeaway? Hope, okay, and hope produces an energy and a flow of power that gives expectation. Everyone who has this hope in in us purifies himself even as he is pure. Yes, that's correct. Anybody else? Yes? Yes.
Faith.
That's what pleases him, isn't it? Very good. All right. And lastly, he secured for himself a And I'm one of those guys. So remember, oh, he's so special. Oh, he's special. It's kind of how you put the emphasis on it, you know? Yeah. Yeah, he's special. And all of them would apply, so we're good. All right. Father, we love you and thank you so much for tonight. Thank you for your word. Help us as we grow together. In Jesus' name, amen.